Okay, so good afternoon, colleagues. Thank you for your attention. I will try to be concise. We'll speak about non-adjuvant therapy, and this can be a part of the combined course of treatment. Now, there are two strategies. When we use chemotherapy prior to a surgery with radiation therapy, depending on prognosis, or we use chemotherapy before the radiation and chemotherapy. I will demonstrate two studies that were carried out over the past 18 months, and then we will discuss the data we have. So we incorporate in our discussion chemotherapist, radiation therapist, and surgeon. So what are the goals? Goals of the adjuvant therapy? Not quite easy at all. If it is prior to the surgery, then reduce the size of the tumor, reduce the risk of metastasizing, create a possibility for surgical treatment. And after surgery, some of the patients do not get radiation therapy. For our country, it's topical because it's not everywhere that there are state-of-the-art methods of radiation therapy. It's not a secret at all. And if we take the peri-radiation therapy, that's to reduce the size of the tumor mostly. What's new in this field? And the first thing we would like to discuss with you, it is an Indian study, a trial published by ASCO last year, and then DSU published this data as well. These are patients with, as we can see, with 1B2, 1B stages, and the control group was getting no adjuvant, and we can see the differences right away. There are three courses of paclitaxel and carboplatin, and if there was a response, then they were getting surgery, and then depending on the risk factors, they were either under observation or were under radiation therapy. We can see that most of the patients, and this is the second B stage, which is typical of our patients, and look attentively what we see. It's the publication of DSU, the non-adjuvant therapy, 316 patients, and nine were not operated on. If we look at the Japanese trials, and we'll see that the surgical intervention is possible for 96 patients after non-adjuvant therapy. And for some reason, 21 patients are lost. And what happens to them? We don't have any data concerning that. Maybe there's just a misprint. What do we have here? Here are the patients with surgery. So half of these actually did not require radiation therapy. There was no prognosis factors. There were no positive margins or damaged nodes, and so the remaining half were getting radiation. So with the use of non-adjuvant, we can avoid radiation therapy in 50% of cases. But if we look at the distant results of this work, here is what we can see. This is the time without any progression. Oh, I can see standard therapy. This is definitely, this is better than the non-adjuvant treatment and surgery. The differences were not that significant at all for the life duration and for survival rates. And well, of course, we're not worsening this particular factor, but there is a reduction of time without progression. That means the radiotherapy nowadays is a standard in treatment, and all the other things, such as chemotherapy prior to surgery, is an experimental mode for the management of patients. We'll go back to these numbers, and the five-year survival is 76% for both groups. Here is what is important. Under the subgroup analysis, it was demonstrated that 2B group with the maximum spread of the disease, definitely for this group, is preferable radiation therapy. And at earlier stages, first B1A, maybe non-adjuvant chemotherapy should be discussed together, but there was was a specific study carried out for this particular cohort of patients. Now, our American and European colleagues, when we looked at this particular survey, they said, now, this trial evokes a lot of questions because there are different drugs of platinum. There are many patients who are not operated on. There is no data on metamorphosis, so it's necessary to carry out analysis in the groups that have gone through surgery. So everyone expected the next trial, hoping that the EOTC trial will give us certain results. And ASCO, just a month ago, was able to get this data. So the same group of patients, 1B2 and 2B, again, standard mode, experimental mode, and non-adjuvant platinum-containing chemotherapy, two courses, then surgery, and then radiation therapy upon indications. And here is what we have in a more detailed way. So now it's interesting that stratification was by age, genotype, and ego, and the institutes that were involved in that. And the institutes were not a part of the analysis, but they might be included at a later stage. Most of the patients were 2B stage, and first B2, just 26% of cases. So it was mostly squamous type. And now, since the results are not published yet, and there are comments certain, there are certain errors in the calculation of the results. For some reason, we will find figure 3-4, and there's a small number, of course, with different other gestotypes for patients, three patients, and 314 in the group of neoadjuvant, and at the type of screening, 17 were deleted, and then plus 12. Because of the inadequate surgery, because chemotherapy had not been administered for them, because and thus 13% of patients were not able to complete treatment by the protocol. So 217 completed the trial. In the control group, the situation is very similar. 7% were not were taken out at screening. 26 for different other reasons, for some errors even, and some did not complete the treatment, so 26% of patients, 230 altogether, completed the treatment. So here is what happens in the group of neoadjuvant therapy, 217. 74 patients, 24%, were not subjected to surgery for different reasons: toxicity of chemotherapy, progression, insufficient response to treatment, patients' refusal. And what is so strange here, 74 patients were not getting the surgical treatment, but 85 did not complete the treatment. Remember the previous slide, 59 against 74. So there is a discrepancy in numbers here. But 74 we will get is out of 85. We extract those patients who either never started chemotherapy or were excluded for different other reasons. So in the evaluation, there are certain mistakes here, that's obvious. And what's important for us? Look at the chemotherapy. So half of the patients were getting monotherapy with cisplatin, and that's it. And this is not even discussed with neoadjuvant therapy. This is a combined sphere. The rest, 20 and 19%. In the group of chemo radiotherapy, where, again, 20 patients were not getting radiation therapy for different reasons, patients' refusal, protocol violation, and so on. And thus, if we look at the tables we have already seen, we can see that 23 patients were not included, were not eligible, and 15 treatment were never started. That's much more than the 20 that we can see here. So we do not know at all how they analyzed the results. So cisplatin was administered to 87%, cisplatin with Taxol as a radiomodifier for 13% of patients. Thus, 96% of patients were able to get the complete course of treatment. What is important for the group with no adjuvant? What is the objective response? We understand with the uterus cancer, we need treatment of partomorphosis. And what do we see in some of the cases? The complete partomorphosis was achieved in 20, in so the best with cisplatin and the and some with cisplatin and palliative excel, and we can see that the differences are not that big. There is a difference just one patient, but 54 in this table, and this table there are 55, as you can see. So the one patient goes here and there. If we analyze it, this is what happens. As for the radiation therapy, again, here is what we can see with a non-adjuvant treatment. The radiotherapy, 73% of patients did not get it, did not get radiation therapy. So after surgery, they were simply under observation, and a very small percentage of patients were subjected to radiation therapy. Now, what is most important? Here is a sub-analysis, very different numbers over here. Where do they get these particular numbers? It's not clear at all. So now let's look at the distance here. Chemo radial therapy, that's blue. Red, no adjuvant therapy plus surgery. And here is what we can see in LSA of intern 63, all the patients who received treatment. We can see here the differences, 74 against 76% in favor of radiotherapy. So that is the overall survival. The results were statistically insignificant, but nonetheless, if we look at the time without progression and reliable differences, then the, we can see that radiation therapy is preferable. Well, of course, the life expectancy over 5 years, and we can see that these two regimens provide similar results. In the group of patients, the other group, again, there was no difference in survival, but there were with time without progression, but the group with radiation therapy shows a higher line than the line with no adjuvant and surgery. The sub-analysis demonstrates that the second B stage is the stage at which radiation therapy is needed. For first B1, the stage, it's possible to discuss an extra research to understand what is indicated for them. Probably a surgery. This needs to be studied.
What our opponent said was that the study was very interesting. However, we need to look forward to our publication, because it's not clear why OS is higher than PFS by 18%. Possibly because this phenomenon is difficult to account for, so we need to look forward to the appearance, to the release of the publication. At present, we still claim that chemo radiotherapy is still the standard, and it needs to follow the protocols designed on the basis of clinical trials. The most effective regimens which enable you to achieve full PSR include cisplatin, where just a few patients required radiotherapy. 5 year survival is much higher, reliably higher. It's 98% compared with the figures in the study that we have discussed, where the survival rate was 75-76%. The same goes for dose-intensive regimens of pre-op chemotherapy. The five-year survival is fairly good compared to other trials that we have discussed previously. So neoadjuvant chemotherapy is a method that is still under analysis. It cannot be included into routine clinical practice. However, it may be effective with patients with 1B2 stage. As far as neoadjuvant therapy prior to radiotherapy is concerned, and radiotherapy is sometimes requested for that, a trial was released in 2018 where the control group with weekly cisplatin was compared with the study group. What we saw was the patients were largely in the 2B, 3A, 3B, 4A stage, and chemo radiotherapy was reliably higher compared to a combination of radio and chemotherapy with pre-op treatment. The curves are not do not display any statistically reliable differences. However, the lower curve is neoadjuvant therapy. The upper curve does not have any advantages compared to chemo radiotherapy. What are the conclusions that we can make? What are the take-home messages? These regimens that we're discussing are only possible within the scope, within the context of clinical trials. We're looking forward to the publication of the findings of the INTERLACE third phase study and the OUTBACK third phase study. Let us see what gets published, and let us discuss the results. In 2015, we started a two-stage trial of neoadjuvant therapy in cervical cancer patients. So our center has departments for radiology, gynecology, The primary endpoint was full PCR. The patients that were included in the trial were 1B, 2A, 2B. The medications included docetaxel, tisplacin, and capecitabine. Constantly before the surgeries and surgical treatment was provided, depending on the risk factors. Depending on the risk factors, we give radiological treatment or not. To achieve our endpoint, we need 36 more patients. At present, we have provided surgeries to 25 patients, most of them young, median age 44. Most of them are 1B, 2A, 2B. All the patients tolerated 8 weeks of chemotherapy. Just one of the patients developed toxicity signs, so she received chemotherapy for 5 weeks, for 4 weeks instead of five. Following the surgery, one of the patients refused from surgery. Another patient was rejected because of thrombosis, and one more patient was rejected because the pathology, the disease, was incurable. PCR was achieved in 4, 5, and 10, four stage, three stage, and stage one and two patients, respectively. The median number of lymph nodes was 46. Eighty-five nodes maximum. Adjuvant therapy was received by just one third of the patients. 66% of the patients are followed up without radiotherapy. So the first remote results, long-term results, are as follows. Just one case of recurrence, one case of disease progression, one death. We need to decide whether we require any 2B patients for the study. The question is still open. We're going to discuss it.